K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we are expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level, or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at sales@k98fm.com.
Listening to a radio station where the mighty hosts of heaven sing. Turn your radio on.
Turn your radio on.
Turn your radio on.
Turn your radio on.
If you want to hear the songs of Zion coming from the land of endless spring,
get in touch with God.
Turn your radio on. Turn your radio on.
Turn your radio on.
And listen to the music in the air.
Turn your radio on.
Turn your radio on. Heaven's glory share.
Amazing grace, Lord, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now was blind, but now I see.
You're listening to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Harden. Richard will guide you through the Bible and help you find God's purpose for your life. Now here's teacher and author Richard Harden.
Welcome to God's Pure Word of Faith. I'm Richard Harden. And again, I want to thank the Lord and the management and staff of K98Talk.com for this great opportunity to again share God's Word with you. Before I get started on the message today, though, I want to share with you about my website so that you'll be able to get in touch with me and find some more materials that you can study during the week and everything.
Visit Richard's website at raharden.com. That's the World Wide Web at raharden.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit Amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Harden to see and purchase his books. You're listening to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Harden. Richard will guide you through the Bible and help you find God's purpose for your life. Now here's teacher and author Richard Harden.
And again, welcome back then. I hope you'll go check out those books there. Now, in the past few weeks, I've been sharing with you about faith, mercy, grace, charity, prosperity, healing. A lot of things that are well, I've shared that you don't hear in the normal messages in your congregations or on radio and TV across our land. Today I'm going to share with you a very, very important subject, and there's going to be a lot of material in here that you've probably never heard before. And my greatest desire is that you'll at least listen to this and pray about it and read and study it, you know, before you rule it out as being, you know, well, too far out of the main line or something, because I'm going to be sharing with you scriptures that go along with everything I say. Now, the fact that you haven't heard these scriptures before is probably because they might be a little controversial, and most ministers are taught not to be controversial because it disturbs people or something. So there's enough subjects right in the main line of Christianity to discuss without having to, you know, share something that might upset someone. Anyway, my belief is that the God of the Bible is getting a very bum rap today by the Christian community. So much so that our secular society feels free to joke and criticize God and Christians just about any time they choose without fear of any type of retribution, not realizing that it's only because of God's great mercy that they're allowed to even take their next breath or speak their next cursings or something. We, the Christian community, are supposed to be ambassadors for Christ, which means that we are charged to speak His word faithfully without adding or taking away from it. In fact, Proverbs chapter 30, verses 5 through 6 says, "Every word of God is pure. He is a shield to them that put their trust in Him. Add thou not unto His words, lest He reprove thee, and thou be found a liar." Now, what it means here about "lest He reprove thee" is that if you state something as God's word, and it's not, you've added to it or something, He won't back it up. He won't back it up unless it's His pure word. Because see, when He speaks, Christ then goes forth. Christ is the living, spoken word of God. When God spoke, "Let there be light," Christ went forth. Christ, the living word. It says in, 1 Corinthians 1:24, the Apostle Paul says, "Christ is the power of God, the creating power of God." And it says Christ is the power of God and the wisdom, the pure word of God. See, so if we change it, then it's not God's pure word. It's our word. And He's not, you know, going to back up just our words. It's His word that goes forth with the creating power of the universe, Christ. Now, so that's why it's important then that we must be diligent in our seeking to receive God's pure word. Now, we have several groups in our society, you know, that say like that speaking of unknown tongues is a gift from God. Well, the scripture says that. Others teach that unknown tongues are the devil. Several groups teach that speaking in unknown tongues is evidence of a Christian being baptized in the Holy Spirit. Yet this combination is never spoken of in the scriptures. That is, it never says they were baptized with the Holy Spirit and spoke in tongues. It says they were filled with the Spirit and spoke in tongues. But see, that's different. Things are being taught that aren't being said in the scripture. Now, the baptism of the Spirit is spoken of by the Apostle Peter in 1 Peter 3:21 as causing salvation. "The like figure, whereunto even baptism does now save us, not to putting away the filth of the flesh, but to answer of good conscience toward God by the resurrection of Jesus Christ." The Apostle Paul also mentions baptism associated with causing salvation, 1 Corinthians 12:13, "For by one Spirit we all baptized into the body." And again in James 1:21, he talks about "Wherefore lay apart all filthiness, superfluity, and naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafting word, which is able to save your souls." The engrafting word. See, here the scripture mentions, like, you know, for salvation, the word of God engrafting us into the body of Christ. And into it. Anyway, we have different denominations that, you know, just teach it. Water baptism or spiritual baptism, and just back and forth. And even praying, which I'm going to be discussing this morning, primarily praying, talking to the Lord, communicating with the Lord, prayer. Many mainline denominational preachers teach you better not pray for healing because the devil performs signs and wonders too. Scares people away from praying for healing even. I've heard them on national television, radio say things like this. And when bad things happen like 9/11, the interviewers on TV talk to preachers and say, well, God's in control, but he works in mysterious ways and something good will come of it. Even though 1 John 5:19 states that the devil is in control of this world. You say, how can the devil be in control? Because Jesus says in Matthew 20:18, all power is given unto me in heaven and earth. The devil does not have power and authority. But now, listen carefully to this. When we reject or neglect any of God's word or will, we're giving Satan advantage in our life and control in that situation. So see, the devil has control when we reject or neglect God's word. Now, for an example, look in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 10 through 11. It states that we must forgive others lest we give Satan the advantage. Now see, unforgiveness across our nation, if Christians would just turn back and ask the Lord to forgive them and pray, and say, Lord, help me to forgive that person, you know, ex-husband or ex-wife or, you know, some family member or somebody at work like this. Many people would get over their sicknesses, get set free of those sicknesses, and there'd be a lot of people's lives changed just praying and asking God to help me forgive that person. I know it's difficult because I've had to forgive people too. You know, we all will have to. The circumstances come up. And it's not the easiest thing to do. In fact, it's very difficult. But it's not just an option and a good principle to live by, you know, if we want to, you know, do the best we can. 2 Corinthians 2, 10-11 says, if we do not forgive others, we are putting our hand in the hand of the devil and giving him control in our life. We'll be out of fellowship with God. Our prayers will be blocked and things like this. So we've got to obey God's word if we expect his blessings. Now, otherwise we're giving devil control. And you know, in our society today, probably 70-80% of the people don't even care about God's word from what it appears. You know, they making jokes about Christianity, jokes about God, and you know, in the national convention a couple of years ago for the Democratic Party, they even three choices voting God out of the platform and everything. See, it's not very popular today to be a Christian and to, you know, be saying or teaching and preaching God's word. But now, we as Christians, if you want to live by God's word, and if you want to live in his blessings and everything, you've got to go along with it. Like in, let's see, Ephesians chapter 4, verses 26-27 says, be angry, sin not, let not the sun go down your wrath, neither give place to the devil. See, when we're violating God's word, we're giving advantage to the devil in our life. That's how the devil has control, as talked about in 1 John 5:19. Even though Jesus has a power and authority, by neglecting God's word, the devil is getting control in most people's lives. Now, Psalms 138:2 says, God has exalted his word above all his names. And that's because God and his word are one and the same. John chapter 1 says, in the beginning was the word, and the word was God, and the word was God. See, so he's exalted his word above his name. We call out to Jesus, the highest name, for salvation. And he responds in by sending his living word into our hearts. Now, if we reject God's word, we're rejecting God himself. In the third part of the Trinity, we're placing our hands willfully in the hands of the devil for him to bring curses, mentioned in Deuteronomy 28. We have the free will choice to choose God and have God in control of our lives. And I pray and seek for God to be in control of my life. But see, I've got to be in obedience to his word. And each of us have to. If we willfully continue to try to draw back to him with love, but he will honor our decisions regardless of which choice we make. Many Christians are living with curses from the devil today because we've rejected God's call to service, or we've believed false teachings. Now see, you may be honest and sincere in what you believe, but if it's not true, God won't back it up. Every word of God is pure. See, and we've got to be confessing and living by God's pure word. And the only way then that we can be pleasing to God is through faith. It says Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, you know, that without faith, it is impossible to please God. That means we're accepting His pure word to faith. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. So it's got to be His pure word, though, that we're claiming in our lives for us to be able to receive the faith that's talked about here. You know, if we're believing a lie, if we're believing a false teaching, I don't care. You believe it with all your heart, you know, and that still is not going to give you the pleasing faith to God. It's only His pure word that we must be seeking and living by. Now, if you've got unforgiveness someone and you've got sicknesses from it, the devil doesn't just, you know, real quick like make you sick or do something to disturb you when you violate God's law, because if he did, he knows you'd turn back to God real quick. But sicknesses and all these cursings in Deuteronomy 28, they come even in Christians' lives if we violate God's law or God's, you know, word for us willfully. If we don't love him enough to forgive other people, see, he has forgiven us so much. And if we don't love him enough to forgive others, see, we're giving Satan advantage in our life. And we're missing in blessings of his promises and protection. And it's just up to us. In Proverbs 26:2, it states, "The curse causeless shall not come." That means these curses in the lives of Christians today are there because of each person, somehow or another, opening the door to give the devil advantage in their life. Because it, like in, let's see, Ephesians 16:6, where it says that we have a shield of faith. A shield of faith will protect us from all the fiery darts of the wicked one. But see, if we're disobeying God's laws, then we don't have that shield of faith up. Or if we may have it up in some areas, but our shield of faith will have holes in it from those areas that we're not, you know, accepting God's word and living by it according to your faith, acceptance and obedience to God's word. You know, now, so if you have a lot of fiery darts coming at you, check out your shield of faith. What is it about the Lord that you're allowing then the devil to come in through? What door do you have open? Unforgiveness, or, you know, just envy, jealousy, greed, and different things like this? Now, again, Proverbs 26:2, the curse causeless shall not come. So then, Ecclesiastes 8:11 shows why it may be hard to relate the curse to the actions that cause it, because sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily, therefore the heart of the sons of men is fully set in them to do evil. Well, you know, the fact that as soon as we violate one of God's laws, the devil just doesn't jump on us real quick then to identify to us that, hey, you open a door, I've got it, because he knows we'll turn back to the Lord, like I said earlier. But when we do that and recognize that we're doing something wrong like that, we need to be praying and seeking for God to, you know, search our hearts and to help us stay in fellowship with Him. And then close these doors of opportunity. Like James 4:7 says, submit to God, submit to His word, resist the devil, and he'll flee. One of the evil things that's really a big problem in our society is like 2 Timothy 1:9. God has called each of us to a special calling. Whoever you are listening, you are so special to God. Listen to this verse. God has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to His own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. Now see, Each of us are so special in God's eyes. He loves us so much, and He wants us to have the best. In fact, He double sealed the promises. It says in Hebrews that He not only speaks the promises to us, but He said He wants the heirs of grace, His children, to enjoy Him so much. He then promised to not break the promises. He double sealed the promises so that we could have a part of this, great life that He has for His children. We're all children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. Now, and most of our society doesn't even care about God's Word. The Christian community is neglecting or just picking and choosing scriptures which make them feel good or which fits their predetermined denominational beliefs, while selecting and neglecting scriptures which contradict their belief. Like for an example, I've heard on TV and radio preachers selling packages of materials to help people get delivered of generational curses. Well, if you look in Ezekiel chapter 18, you can get rid of them free, because Ezekiel chapter 18 says there is no such thing as generational curses anymore, and there hasn't been for centuries. But yet they're still teaching and preaching all across the nation about getting rid of generational curses and everything. Also, you'll hear different groups, like the Word of Faith group during the Easter season, probably this week or something, will be teaching that Jesus went to hell, fought the devil, and came out of the grave victorious over death and hell, and with the keys of the kingdom, captured from the devil. Well, see, there's a big problem with that inspiring message, is that the devil's never been in hell. He's not in hell today. He's never been in hell. He's not going to hell. If you look in Revelation chapter 20, verse 10, the devil is cast into the lake of fire in Revelation chapter 20, verse 10, before the white throne judgment, and he will not be the supervisor. It says he's down there tormenting people or something like that. He'll be tormented himself day and night for eternity. Now, after the Revelation chapter 20 verse 10, have the white throne judgment, and then it says hell and everything in it will be emptied in the lake of fire later in verse 13, after the devil has been cast in the lake of fire in verse 10. See, the devil is here on earth today. He's not in hell right now. Jesus couldn't go down to hell and fight him. Jesus fought him here by his perfect walk of faith, his obedience to his Father's word, and his sprinkling of his blood seven times on the cross as he was dying and everything. And then right at the end, when Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing." See, he asked that forgiveness and for his Father to forgive them everything, to make sure that he was forgiven everybody that has done those things to him, putting him on the cross and stuff. So that was where his victory was. Fighting the devil here from those temptations and throughout his lifetime ministry and everything, where the devil kept trying to get him to disobey his Father's will, and he didn't, and he said on the cross, "It is finished." See, he didn't go to hell to fight the devil. The devil's not there, never will be there. He'll be in a lake of fire though. Now, I hope in some of these following scriptures like this will assist you in learning to hear God's voice, so you will then be able to draw closer to God in your personal walk of faith and be, a brighter light to those people around you and everything. We need to be shining our light so bright because we are Jesus' ambassadors today. We're supposed to be sharing His Word, His living Word, and His life to others so they can see us. And 1 Peter 2:9 says, "But you're a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praise of Him who has called you out of darkness into marvelous light." Now, prayer changes things is the title of this message today. There are so many scriptures that show that God loves us so much that He will actually make changes, real changes. And that's what I want to be discussing to you, coming up right after this break here. But I'll take a short break now and be right back.
The staff of K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network is proud to announce that our very own Rowdy Rick Robinson has been selected as one of the top conservative talk show hosts in the nation for his program America Off the Rails. Again, congratulations to Rowdy Rick Robinson for a job well done and another reason to stay connected to K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network. Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books.
And praise the Lord. Welcome back. I gave a little introductory type presentation there about the different things going on in our society, the different, you know, beliefs of the denominations and everything, because the Apostle Paul, if you look at Ephesians chapter 4, verse 4, states that there's one God, one Spirit, and he says one faith. And that's in about verse 4 and 5. If you move up to then verse 13, it says that we should all be seeking as a body of Christ to come into the unity of that one faith. And he says that we're babes in Christ until we do. Now, he also goes in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, it talks about the Christians in Corinthians, you know, had a lot of sins, and they had even sexual sin in the church and things like this. But before he addressed all those, he jumped on the people. He said, some of you say you're Apollos, some of you say you're Paul. He said, you know, I didn't die for you on a cross like this. He said, you're babes in Christ, you know, until you get this division straightened out. And see, what he says over and over is that there shouldn't be, you know, even 2 separate, what you call denominations, or 2 separate groups of people claiming to be Christians. Because, see, the Lord has promised if we humble ourselves and come to him, he'll show us a way. He'll speak to us. And we should be able to learn to hear his voice as though, you know, someone that we've lived with and talked with and walked with. And that's what it should be in our life. You know, Jesus says in John chapter 10, says, my sheep hear my voice, and all others they'll flee. And it's like if, you know, a husband and wife or somebody goes to a big party and they get separated. You could put a blindfold on me in a big room in a party like that and lead me around, I could pick out my wife's voice without having to see her. And that's the way it should be with Jesus. In all these voices we hear in our society, and all these different things coming from the devil through people and everything like that, we should be able to hear God's voice just as clear as we could hear our wife or your friend or your husband or something like that. You know, the voice of someone that you've lived with and talked with like this and are close to, you can pick out their voice without seeing them. And that's the way it should be with us in Jesus. He said, my sheep will hear my voice, from all others they'll flee. We need to be taking the time to seek God's pure word. Now, in John 15:7, Jesus says, if ye abide in me, and my words abide in you. See, that's his words, his pure word now. Not just what your denomination says, not just what you think is God's word or sounds like it should be, but looking, praying, and seeking, finding God's pure word. If ye abide in me and my words abide in you, Jesus says, ask what you will and it shall be done unto you. And then in 1 John 3, 26, excuse me, 1 John 3, 26, let me find it. I don't have that right here with me, but I want to show you this. So I get excited here. 1 John 3:22, excuse me. And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him because. Now listen to what this because is now. Why do we receive whatever we ask? Because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. And what are those things that are pleasing in his sight? Accepting and walking with him by faith. Accepting his words. He said so many times in Scripture, if you love me, obey my commandments. If you love me, do this. If you love me, you know, accept my words. So accepting and receiving his words in our hearts. So that is the basis of our prayers, that we are praying by faith. James chapter 1 says we must pray by faith. That means we must be praying according to God's word. Faith comes by hearing, hearing the word of God, but only if we accept what we hear. And like in Psalms 119:9, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto according to God's word. So see, we must not only be in a position of knowing God's word, but we've got to be taking heed to it, like I mentioned a while ago. Forgive others, lest you give Satan advantage. We should be heeding that word and say, Lord, please help me to forgive that person. You know how I feel. Please help me to forgive. Now, do our prayers change things? Are our prayers really that important? Have our prayers ever changed anything? Now, I believe the answer to these questions are yes. Our prayers are that important, that when we talk to God about things, that often he changes things. Our prayers really do change things. Our prayers are important. Our prayers have resulted in changes. And I believe that's so important that that's why the devil has, you know, tried to keep people from realizing how important their prayers are. You know, don't wait till the doctor gives up and everything and then say, let's pray. Philippians 4:6 says, be anxious for nothing, but all things with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. When you start getting anxious about something, start praying. And I believe since our prayers do change things, that God himself, now listen to this, must not have known what was going to happen, or it would not have been a change. Now think about that. Now don't just change channels or something like that real quick. In Proverbs 18:13 now, it says, he that answers a matter before he hears it, it is folly and a shame to him. So before you tune off, think about this. If our prayers are going to change something, that means something, God is going to do something that he wasn't going to do before. Or it wouldn't be a change, it'd just be predestination, and that he was making us pray, and then he's going to do what we pray, and like this. See, and that don't make sense with a loving God. These things are not predestined like that, ever, step of the way. Now, I'm going to show you scripture after scripture after scripture what I'm talking about. And that God changes things because of our prayers. He loves us so much, all through the scripture. Now, attributes of God. I won't say characteristics, but attributes. What it means for God to change, and then discuss the great importance of God changing to each of us in our personal lives. That's because you can talk to the Lord about your situation. That's why it's so important. See, I don't care what's circumstance you're in right now. Can't doctor say you got 2 weeks to live or 3 months to live or something like this? The doctors, God controls our death. God controls when we leave this physical life. Talk to him about it. Now, one of these attributes that we need to understand about God, I'm trying to get it real quick here, is that God is love. In reality, love is not a characteristic of God. Scripture states in 1 John 4:8, for God is love. And in verse 16, God is love. Now, if this is true, then teachings that I've heard about three different kind of loves, eros, phileo, and agape, see, if God is love, nothing else can be love. See, eros is not love. Eros is just strong physical emotional attractions, you know, focused on a physical appearance or some kind of physical type attraction, sexual type. That's not love. That's a strong physical attraction because, you know, like a scripture says, love never fails. Well, you know, people get tired. Look at these Hollywood people and everything like that. You know, married 6 weeks, married, you know, sometimes a day and a half or two or three days like that. You know, sex isn't love. Sex is a strong physical attraction. Phileo. It says, you know, like the brotherly type love and everything. That's not, phileo is not love. Phileo is a strong physical, emotional attraction focused on just friendliness and kindness, like this. See, those words shouldn't have been changed when they were, you know, translated into our language and given new words, something like that. It should be just, that's what they are. They're not love, though. God is love, and he says, beside me there is no other God. That means beside him there is no other love. Now think about that as we go through here. God is has a perfect love for each of us. He loves us as much as he loved Jesus. In fact, he only has one perfect love, and that's himself. God is love. Nothing else is love. Now, one of the characteristics of God, though, that he set up is he will not force anyone to accept him or to reject him. The second area we should consider is that when we're praying, this means that we could pray all our life for God to save someone, and God will bless that person more. He'll cause witnesses to go to that person. He'll cause many good things to happen to that person. But he will not force that person to accept his love into their heart against their free will. Each one of us must humble ourselves to God's word, humble ourselves and repent, ask God's forgiveness, and personally invite the Spirit of Christ into our heart to receive salvation. Now, if we're praying for someone, it's like a sunlight shining through on a cloudy day on some little spot on the earth. You've seen these rays of sunlight come down. On that one little spot there, it looks like a sunny day to that spot, you know, that's sun coming through the clouds and shining on it. But that's the way it is that, to me. I imagine that when we're praying for our loved ones, there's enough light in the world as it is. Romans chapter 1 says that, you know, the creation just, you know, tells about God and everything. We're all without excuse. But yet when we pray for our loved ones and everything, it's like God intensifies his love to them. Somehow or another, he shares more of himself with them or something because of our prayers. And I've had some just in the last few weeks for close loved ones where they come back and tell me things happened in their life, and I know it was a result of my prayers because it was so different what happened and everything. Now, he won't force any of us to praise him, serve him, or to respond positively to any of his desires, any of his love to us, his mercy to us, his one-way love to us, protecting us, in, even when we're sinners. In fact, it says in a Romans 2:4, it says that God blesses lost people to draw them to repentance. See, he blessed us all those years before we turned to him with all our heart and invited him to come in. So he doesn't love us anymore as his children. We're his children. He's pleased with us because of us accepting him and coming into fellowship and living with him. But he loved us with a perfect love when we were out there in a world of sin, following the lusts of the world and all this. See, he loved us with a perfect love then. Same love that he has for us now. You know, as far as he is the perfect love. God is love. Now, and he tries to draw lost people out of, you know, sinful things by his love. Like it said, like in Romans, despises thou the riches, goodness, and forbearance, long-suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. Now, if he wanted to, he could make all of us worship him. But that's not his desire. He wants us to love and care for him enough that when he reveals his love to us, that we accept his love. And he's promised to bring everybody to that point. Grace of God that bringeth salvation appeared to all men. And he blesses lost people so much to draw lost people to him. And he wants us to go to them and share with them and you know, be a testimony of what God will do in his children's lives. Now, even though God won't, you know, God won't force anybody to praise him or worship him, something like this, he's going to force everybody to bow, though. If you don't bow here on earth, you'll bow when you stand before him like this. We all will bow our knee to Jesus. And I pray that you'll bow your knee before you leave this physical world. Now, God won't cause anybody to curse him to refuse to serve him or anything like this. See, he won't push anybody away from him. His love is to attract people to him. It's not God's will that any should perish, but all should come to repentance. In fact, in Ezekiel 33:11, God says, he doesn't rejoice in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked come to him and turn from their wicked way and live. Now, so God is love, and he won't force any of us to worship or to, you know, reject him. Now, and what I'm going to share here is that, you know, you've probably heard many messages where God forgives our sins and forgets. Well, think about that now. If he forgets our sins, that means there's a lot he doesn't know. And, you know, so many people say God knows everything. And it sounds great that we have a God that knows everything, except if you look at why he doesn't know everything, he forgives our sins and forgets. Now, that's good, isn't it? He forgives and forgets. When we stand before Christ, at the judgment seat of Christ, we're going to answer for the good and bad. Well, our forgiven sins won't be there because, see, he won't remember them. God doesn't remember our sins against us, as far as east is from the west and everything. So it's good that God has chosen to completely wipe out our sins and forget them. Now, isn't it possible maybe in some other area, because of God's love for us, that he's done about the same thing? And he has. He has given us the free will to make choices. The free will to make our choices. And he has, in a sense, given up his ability to know which choice we'll make. Now, he knows what will happen if we choose his will, and he knows what will happen if we reject his will, and you might say choose the devil's, you know, lies and deceit. But until we make the choice, now that's what I want to show you this morning, that he does not know which choice we'll make until we make them. Because, you know, he forgives and forgets our sins because he loves us so much. And then, like Isaiah 43:25, even I am he that blotteth out thy transgressions. For my own sake, I will not remember thy sins. And then Hebrews 8:12, for I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and iniquities I will remember no more. See, so he knows which way we will or won't, you know, what will happen if we choose his way and what will happen if we reject it. Now, let me read you some of these scriptures here. Well, God cannot lie. And what we mean by lie now is, suppose I say I'll meet you later on today at church. And as I'm going to church, my car breaks down and I can't get there. See, I didn't get to meet you at church, but I didn't lie to you. When I told you I was going to meet you at church, I truly meant it. Now, suppose that I'm going to church and I see a car wreck and I see some sick people and hurt people and everything, and I stop to help them. See, that wouldn't be a lie because I didn't get to church. It's just I fully intended to when I told you that. But now, suppose I would say I'll meet you later on today to go to church, and I know that I have a tea time for 9:00 this morning and I'm going to be out there on the golf course, but I just told you that so maybe you'd go to church and get something good out of it. Now see, that would be a lie. I'd be manipulating you. And I want you to remember that in these scriptures now. God does not tell people one thing and do something else to manipulate them. That would be a lie. It's impossible for God to lie. So as we take a look at these scriptures, keep that in mind. It's impossible for God to manipulate people, telling them one thing and then doing something else like that. We'll start with Moses. In Exodus chapter 32, verse 9 to 14, the Lord said to Moses, I have seen this people. Behold, it is a stiff-necked people. Now therefore let me alone, that my wrath may wax hot against them, and that I may consume them, and I'll make thee a great nation. And Moses besought the Lord his God and said, Lord, why dost thou wax hot against thy people, which thou hast brought forth out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Therefore, if you do that, he's saying, the Egyptians will speak and say, for mischief did he, God, bring them out to slay them in the mountains and consume them from the face of the earth. And then he says, turn from thy fierce wrath. He's speaking to God now. and repent of this evil against thy people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, thy servants, to whom thou swearest for thine own self, and said unto them, I will multiply your seed as the stars of heaven, and all this land I have spoken I will give to your seed, and they shall inherit it forever. And the Lord repented of the evil which he thought to do in this people. Then Exodus 32:22, Moses said, yet now, if thou wilt forgive their sin, this is Moses speaking again, and if not, blot me out. Blot me out, I pray, out of the book which thou hast written. Now, because of Moses' love and God's love for Moses and Moses talking, standing in for the people like that, God changed. And if you look in Psalms 106, you know, like Psalms 106 verifies this too. Psalms 106 verse 23. Scripture says, therefore he said that he would not destroy them. That is, God said he would not destroy them, had not Moses, his chosen, stood before him in the breach to turn away his wrath, lest he should destroy them. See, God changed because Moses stepped in. Now, see the importance of that. God could not have known Moses would decide to step in, or his first statement would have been a lie to him. God cannot lie. Therefore, he did not know Moses was going to step in and defend the people and everything. If he had have known that, he would have just been manipulating Moses to do that. But he didn't lie to Moses. He intended to destroy them. And that's what the scripture says, plain as it can be. Now, look at the book of Jonah. It's a little bit clearer here. In the book of Jonah, God sent Jonah to give the people of Nineveh a message. The message is given then in Jonah chapter 3, verses 4 to 5. And Jonah began to enter the city a day's journey, and he cried and said, yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. See, 40 days, they're going to be overthrown, destroyed. So the people of Nineveh believed God and proclaimed a fast, put on sackcloth from the greatest of them to the least of them. Now, even the evil king of Nineveh stated in Jonah chapter 3, verse 9 to 10, who can tell if God will turn and repent and turn away from this fierce anger, that we perish not? And God saw their works, that they turned from their evil way, and God repented of the evil and that he had said that he would do to them, and he did it not. See, it doesn't say that. Now, the message Jonah sent wasn't 40 days you're going to, you know, be overthrown if you don't repent or something. That wasn't part of the message. God told him, go tell them in 40 days they were going to be destroyed. But now God says here, repented of the evil, or that destroying them, that he had said that he would do to them, and he did it not. And see, the scripture says it in black and white. It was God's word to Nineveh, that city, that everyone should perish in 40 days. Now, why didn't God destroy Nineveh? Because the people turned with all their heart to him in love. They repented. Now, you say, well, what if they were faking it? Well, God would have known if they were faking it. See, he wouldn't have done that if they were faking it. He knew their hearts. He knew that there was true repentance, and that evil king had enough sense to get his people to do that. But God, because of God's love, and all of Nineveh turned in prayer, God turned from his anger and changed, like he changed for Moses. You see? That should encourage us to turn to God with all our problems. Even the evil king of Nineveh knew enough to realize that if he and his people turn to God in true, honest, asking forgiveness and everything, that God might hear an answer. Now, see, Jonah also knew that, because that's one of the main reasons that Jonah ran from God, didn't want to go to Nineveh. Jonah didn't like the Ninevites for some reason or other. It doesn't say why, but in chapter 4, verse 2, it says, and he prayed unto the Lord and said, I pray thee, O Lord, was not this my saying when I was in my country? Therefore I fled into Tarshish. For I knew that thou art a gracious God, and merciful, slow to anger, and great kindness, and repentest thee of the evil. Therefore now, O Lord, I beseech thee, take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. See, he was so upset. But he knew that that was the kind of God that we have, is a God that will actually turn, you know. And when people love him and turn in repentance in their heart, then God will change what it is he's spoken against them. Now, God finally told Jonah said like that, that Jonah had pity on a tree that God had let grow up real quick to give him some shade. And then said, Lord, thou hast had pity on this gourd or this tree for which thou had not labored, neither made it to grow, which came up in night and perished in a night. And should not I spare Nineveh, the great city, where are more than 64,000 persons that cannot discern from their right hand to their left? See, he said he loved them so much. Now, see, that ought to encourage you right there to start praying and seeking God for whatever your problem or situation is. God changed because of their honest repentance and prayers. Prayers change God, and God changes things. See, it's not that we change things, but we talk to God about our problem, and He changes things. In 1 Samuel chapter 9, here God changed because of King Saul's disobedience. King Saul was the first king of the children of Israel. They had been ruled by judges and everything, and they cried out for a king. And here Samuel, 1 Samuel chapter 9, verse 2, Saul is described. And he, speaking of Saul's dad, had a son whose name was Saul, a choice young man and godly. And there was not among the children of Israel a goodlier person than he. Now remember, God chose Saul. Here in 1 Samuel 10, verse 24, Scripture states, and Samuel the high priest said to all the people, see ye him who the Lord has chosen. See, God chose Saul to be the first king, that there is none like him among all the people. And Saul, you know, was the best choice, and God picked him out. But in 1 Samuel 15, 10, God states, then the word of the Lord came to Samuel, saying, it repenteth me I have set up Saul to be king, for he has turned back from following me and has not performed my commandments. And in verse 35, it states again, and the Lord repented that he had made Saul king over Israel. Now, if God had known ahead of time that King Saul was going to reject his word, reject his laws and things like this, what did it, you know, if the Lord picked him knowing that he was going to be that way, why would the Lord say he repented that he had made Saul king over Israel? There wouldn't have been anything for him to repent for, because see, he had picked him knowing it was going to happen. But see, that's not it. He doesn't know our choices. He knows what happened if we choose his way. He knows what will happen if we don't. But out of his love, he tries to draw us to make his, you know, choice that he wants us to, because we love him enough. And it shows that God has chosen, had chosen the best person at that time to be king. And God knew their hearts, so Saul was the best choice. If God had known that Saul was going to turn from his commandments, God would not have had anything to repent from, since he would have already known that Saul was going to do it when he picked him. But he didn't know, see? Now, that's about like King Asa. King Asa in, let's see, what is it? 2 Chronicles, chapters 14, 15, 16, along there. When he was young, he served the Lord. He did what was right. God blessed him. Then they had about 20 years of peace or 25 years of peace. And he fortified the cities and all this stuff. And he started putting his trust in things and his own fortifications of the city. When an army came against him, he went to Egypt then to get help. Well, God let him have the victory. But then after King Asa and Egypt had won the victory, God sent a prophet to Asa and said, when you were young, you know, you and I fellowshiped together and everything. And, you know, I blessed you so much. But now you turned aside and I told you not to go to Egypt. But you did. King Asa didn't do like King David and repent and ask forgiveness. Asa persecuted the prophet, put him in prison. The king did. And he still wouldn't turn to the Lord and repent. He went to all the doctors in this country and died of a foot infection. And the scripture says, because he would not turn to the Lord. Now, there's another example in, excuse me here, 2 Kings chapter 20. It's very plain that God changed could not have known beforehand how King Hezekiah would react. In those days, this is 2 Kings chapter 20 now, verses 1 through 5. In those days was Hezekiah the king sick unto death, and the prophet Isaiah the son of Amos came to him and said unto him, Thus saith the Lord, set thy house in order, for thou shalt die and not live. Well, evidently Hezekiah didn't like that prophecy so well, so listen to verse 2. Then he, Hezekiah, turned his face to the wall and prayed unto the Lord, talked to the Lord about it, saying, I beseech thee, O Lord, remember now I have walked before thee in truth and with a perfect heart. Now, that's not a perfect heart like we think a perfect heart, you know. It's just that he had tried to live a godly life. And throughout his years and everything, he had tried to. But even though he may have said it, you know, a little wrong here, God knew what he meant. He said, I beseech thee, O Lord, remember now I have walked before thee in truth and with a perfect heart and have done that which is good in thy sight. And he wept sore. And next verse, and it came to pass before Isaiah had gone out of the middle of the court that the word of the Lord, now the word of the Lord is Christ. You know, Christ is God's living word. God spoke, let there be light. Christ went forth and produced a light. And in Hebrews 11:26, it says, Moses esteemed the riches of Christ greater than all the wealth of Egypt. See, God was speaking to Moses. That was Christ, the living word. You know, God spoke and Christ goes forth then. And it was Christ here then. In the middle, it said, came to pass before he had gone out of the middle court, the word of the Lord, Christ, came to him saying, Turn again and tell Hezekiah, the captain of my people, Thus saith the Lord, God of David, thy father, I have heard thy prayers, I have seen thy tears. Behold, I will heal thee on the third day thou shalt go up. Now, if God had known beforehand that Hezekiah was going to pray and talk to him about it, and he was going to heal Hezekiah, then the first message he gave Isaiah would have been a lie. And it's impossible for God to lie. So God truly meant when he sent Isaiah to say, set your house in order, you're going to die. So God couldn't have known what was going to happen there afterwards, or it would have been a lie to the prophet. So let's see. This should again encourage you that your prayers are so important. Our lives are not set in concrete with all our choices already made. We have a free will of choices. God encourages us to make his choice, but he won't make us make it. Prayer, talking to God as a friend, does change things. Don't accept those things in your life right now that are hindering you or that you're hurting about, that you're crying about, everything, until you've truly talked with God with all your heart, okay? It may be that he will change them. And I believe he will, because he loves people come to him like that. He changed for Hezekiah, and he'll change for us too. And you say, Hezekiah was king. But see, God is not a respecter of kings. Look what he did to King Saul when King Saul rejected him. He pulled his spirit from King Saul and everything. And in the book of James chapter 2, verse 9, it says, respect of persons is sin. And when Moses struck the rock instead of speaking to it, he lost his entrance into the promised land. So see, God doesn't respect people for the positions he's put them in. He respects people that accept and obey his word. He accepts accepting faith. He respects people that walk by faith, that hear his word, accept and obey it. Now, he changed for Hezekiah and he'll change for us too. And not only that, he gave him 15 more years to live. See, our time of death is not set in concrete when it's going to be. So many people say, well, if it's my time to die, I'll die. And if it's not, I'll live. That's not true. We can talk to God about it like Hezekiah did here, because he didn't add life to Hezekiah because he was king. He did it because he had been trying to be a godly king. He had been trying to serve God as a king. Okay? And God is not a respecter of persons. He respects our faith, our acceptance, and obedience to his word. And if he changed the death time for Hezekiah, he'll change it for us too. So anyway, I don't care how close you are to what the doctors say now to death, talk to the Lord about it. God can make a difference. Now, we have a predestined path of service, and that's what's important in God's eyes to us. And again, he saved us and called us to a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, created in Christ Jesus before the world began. If you've never sought that holy calling of God, start right now seeking it. Seek his holy calling. And I'm going to take a short break here, and I'll be right back.
Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books.
Plan of salvation has been written in God's holy word. Come with me down the Roman road and I'll show you the things that I've heard. Romans 3:23, the Bible says, we've sinned and come short of God's glory. We're all sinners by nature through Adam's sin, as written in the first Bible story. Romans 5:8 speaks of God's love and the fact that Christ died for us. While we were yet sinners, Christ shed his blood on the cross for our sinful lust. Romans 6:23 says the wages of sin is death for an eternity strife. But the gift of God's love through Jesus Christ gives us eternal life. Romans 10:9, if we can believe that Jesus was raised from the dead by God's divine resurrection, by faith, as the Bible said. The 10th verse says, with a mouth confession, salvation can be made. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord will be saved.
The Bible tells salvation's plan, and the Christian must carry on the Lord. So go tell salvation's plan, take someone down the old Roman road.
Today is the day of salvation. So don't put it off or delay. Just bow your head and repeat after me this simple prayer that I pray. Lord, I know I'm a sinner, lost in sin without Christ. By accepting Jesus my Savior, I can have that eternal life. Forgive me of my sin, O God, and save my soul today. Come into my life to live. In Jesus' name I pray. You're now a Christian saved by grace. So carry on the load. Take someone else, God's simple plan, down the Roman road.
The Bible tells salvation's plan, and a Christian must carry on the load. So go tell salvation's plan, take someone down the old Roman road. Take someone.
Richard's programs will be broadcast live each Sunday morning, 7 Eastern, 6 Central, on K98Talk.com. A podcast will be made so you can listen anytime after the broadcast on Spreaker.com. Put in the search for K98 Talk, then go to the podcast and search for God's Pure Word of Faith, or GPWF. We'll be right back with more of God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Harden right here on K98 Talk.
We got the sound coming back now. I'm not sure what was going on then, but I lost the sound. Let's get back to the scriptures here on prayer changes things. We just found out that God changed for King Hezekiah, and King Hezekiah talked to the Lord about his situation. And you know, God even moved the earth and the sun to prove to King Hezekiah that Isaiah was speaking his word. That when Isaiah came back and said, you're going to live, even though those two prophecies to King Hezekiah looked like they were opposite, one said you're going to die and one said you're going to live, Hezekiah asked Isaiah and said, give me a sign. What sign shall I have that the Lord is going to do this? And he said, shall the shadow on the sundial go forward 10 degrees or go backward 10 degrees? And Hezekiah told him, said, you know, well, let it go backward 10 degrees then. Isaiah prayed, talked to the Lord, and God moved the earth and the sun to where the shadow on the sundial reversed itself and went backward 10 degrees to prove to King Hezekiah that both of those prophecies that he had given were God's word. Now, so it is so important like that, that God loves and cares for so much that he will change like that. Here's an example of where God just changed because of his mercy, and the people didn't really change in this particular case, but because of his love. In 1 Chronicles chapter 20, verses 14-15, the scripture states, so the Lord sent pestilence upon Israel, and there fell of Israel 70,000 men, and God sent an angel into Jerusalem to destroy it. And as he was destroying, the Lord beheld, and he said, and God repented him of the evil, and said to the angel that destroyed, it is enough, stay now thy hand. And the angel of the Lord stood by the threshing floor of Omer in the Jebusite. Sometimes God in his mercy will change things even when people do not pray. In his mercy and his love for us. As Christians though, even though God does that in his mercy for us sometimes, and we're Christians and supposedly profess to be children of God, and we love him with all our hearts, We should not wait for God in His mercy to change things for us. Well, again, Philippians 4:6 is, be anxious for nothing, but in all things with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. Talk to Him about it early. Don't wait till the doctors give up. When you first get the inclination you might have cancer, when you might have a sickness, when you have a concern, it says be anxious for nothing. Talk to Him daily about all your concerns. If you're concerned about it, He's concerned about it. Now, God changed things for people in the Scriptures, which He left as our guide. See, every Scripture is good for instruction and for correction and doctrine. And He left these examples in here for us as our guide to a relationship with Him. God's not a respecter of person. He respects acceptance and obedience to faith. Now, or acceptance and obedience of His Word. See, His living Word, Christ. Christ is a living Word of God. Again, 1 Corinthians 1:24 says, Christ, the power of God. See, the creating power of God and wisdom. God's pure Word. So when we're accepting His Word to faith, we're accepting Christ to faith for that situation. We're accepting His Word for whatever He's spoken to us in that situation. Now, He wants to change. In 2 Chronicles 7:14, you've heard this so many times, at least, I say maybe you haven't. I guess I kind of have this idea that most people have been to church some, but I've met a lot of people lately that haven't been to church, don't even have Bibles. But I grew up in a Baptist children's home, and we had revivals in the spring, revivals in the fall. And every revival, there was a message on this verse, 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people, which are called by name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, and He's talking about His people turning from wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and heal their land. Now, if the Apostle Paul thought that the people of Corinth was babes in Christ in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1 through 3, where some were saying, I'm Apollos, and others saying, I'm a Paul, and he thought they were babes in Christ for that. Can you imagine what he would call our society when we have 300 or 400 different denominations and groups and everything, believing this and believing that? See, we certainly would be babes in Christ too. Now, what are the wicked ways? The wicked ways of our Christian society is that not taking the time to talk to the Lord and find His pure word, Christ. We're not honoring Christ with our time as far as seeking Him for the living word. Because see, when God speaks to us Christ, the living word, then we can accept His word then to faith. But if we're not accepting His pure word, we're not receiving faith. For an example, that scripture I've already quoted a couple of times about He saved us and called us to a holy calling. Have you sought your holy calling? If you haven't, it's evil in your life. In 2 Chronicles 12:14 now, the scripture says that Solomon's son did evil because he prepared not his heart to seek the Lord. We have the choice as to whether we want God working with us or not. As long as we continue and, just going our way and laying the Bible down from Sunday to Sunday, we take it to church or maybe and bring it home, lay it down, don't look at it, don't read it. As long as we continue with, the common sins of unforgiveness, holding unforgiveness, grudges, lying, stealing, cheating, treating family members ungodly, and things like this, gossiping, envy, things, that God instructs us not to. Pray for those that despitefully use us. He that knoweth do good and doeth not, to him it is sin. When we're rejecting God's living word to us, we're not, living by faith like He wants us to. And those are the evil ways of His people today, and that's why our society is in such trouble as it is, and Christians are so disrespected. Now, If we'll humble ourselves, pray, seek Him, and turn from these sins in our heart, then He'll hear and answer. Now listen to what happened to some of the people in Israel. It says in 2 Chronicles 12, verses 6 and 7, whereupon the princes of Israel and the king humbled themselves, and they said, "The Lord is righteous." And when the Lord saw that they humbled themselves, the word of the Lord, Christ, the word of the Lord came to Shemaiah, saying, "They have humbled themselves, therefore I will not destroy them, but I will grant them some deliverance, and my wrath shall not be poured out upon Jerusalem by the hand of Shishak." Now the actions of these princes of Israel are an example of promise in chapter 2 Chronicles 7:14. If His people humble themselves, pray, and seek Him, turn from their sin, then He'll hear from heaven and answer. See, that's what they did here in 2 Chronicles chapter 12. And that's what we need to do. And the evil ways are that we're rejecting so much of God's Word and thinking it's not that important. Oh, well, you know, I can't forgive that person. They did me so wrong. It was so terrible and everything what they did and just cheated me so bad. I'll never forgive them. You know, I've heard people say things like that. But what do you think about Jesus on the cross when He said, "Bless, you know, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." The people crucifying Him on the cross, driving the nails in His hands and feet and stripes on His back and all that stuff. He's praying for God to forgive them. And He's forgiven each of us so much, we should be willing to forgive others. If we love the Lord, at least we'll try to. We'll say, "Lord, help me to forgive that person." You know, keep praying for that person and praying for yourself. Pray for that person and pray, "God, help me to forgive them." And you'll come to the point where God will help you and you will forgive that person. God says He'll change if we change. Jeremiah 18:8. God clearly states that He wants to change depending on what we choose to do. He says, "If a nation against whom I've pronounced turn from their evil, I will repent of the evil that I thought to do to them. And at what instant I shall speak concerning a nation and concerning the kingdom to build it." Now, like here in the United States, he helped build this country through our forefathers and everything. I don't care what the historians and people say today and everything like this. This was built by Christian people and Christian principles. And he says here, "At what instant I shall speak concerning a nation, concerning a kingdom, to build and to plant it. If it do evil in my sight, and it obey not my voice, then I will repent the good wherewith I said I would benefit them." And you know, God even promised to people back in, you know, coming out of, you know, slavery, going to the promised land and everything, he promised them, if they served Him, that He would give them the rains in the spring and rains in the fall. He'd heal our land. And that's what it says in 2 Chronicles 7:14, that if we will humble ourselves and turn our sin, He'll heal our land. Look at all these disasters and everything like that we've had, like that. God will heal this. Now, if God already knew ahead of time which way the people would respond, His first decrees and pronouncements would be only to manipulate people to do what He already predestined. And that would be a lie. And God doesn't lie. He wants us to turn from our wicked ways because we love and care for Him enough. God says the rule is that He will change if people turn from evil to Him. And He'll also change if people turn from Him to evil. But He gives us total free will to choose, and then He honors our choice. He stands by our choice, and we must too. And that's what's got our society in this, with all these different denominations and disagreeing on this scripture and disagreeing on that scripture, and, you know, not coming together in love and fellowship, seeking the right interpretation and stuff. People go off to these seminaries, and they don't go to these seminaries, you know, to learn God's pure word. They go to learn how to interpret God's word. In the scripture, they learn how to interpret it according to their denominational beliefs. And the Baptists believe so different than the Catholics and the Mormons, you know, and different ones, you know, just all these, you know, the Pentecostal beliefs are different from the Nazarene and back and forth and like this, you know, and just such a mess. We are only supposed to have one group of people who have received the Spirit of Christ in our heart, like Ezekiel 36:26 says, where God says, prophesying what He was going to do, He said, a new heart also will I give you. A new spirit will I put within you. I'll take away the stony heart out of your flesh. I'll give you a heart of flesh. And I'll put my spirit in you. See, and that's when we become a child of God, is when he puts his spirit in us. And we should only have one group. Oh, and that's when we're born into the family. See, that Jesus says in John chapter 3, you must be born again. We're born into the family when he puts his spirit in us. We become a child of God, a joint heir with Jesus. Like Galatians 4:6 says, and because your sons, God has sent forth the spirit of his son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Wherefore you're no longer a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. Joint heir with Jesus. Colossians 1:27, the mystery of the gospel. Reason of mystery, because people in the Old Testament didn't know what he was talking about. You know, God in you, that, you know, they didn't know what that was. But he said, the mystery of the gospel, Christ in us, Christ, the living word in us, our hope of glory. See, so that's, we've got to, you know, turn to the Lord with all our heart. And we need to be seeking him, taking the time to seek his holy calling. And if you know to do good and doeth it not, that's sin. Don't make it sin in your life. Do what you know to do. I wish a lot of you get together on this and help me get this word out across our nation and everything like this, because even though we have so many religious Christian organizations, they're not trying to come together in God's pure word. In Jeremiah chapter 3, God pleads with Israel to turn to him. It says, the Lord said unto me, in the days of Josiah the king, hast thou seen that backsliding, what backsliding Israel has done? She has gone up on every high mountain under every green tree, and there played the harlot. And I said, after she's done all these things, turn thou to me. But she turned not, and her treacherous sister Judah saw it. And the Lord said to me, the backsliding Israel has justified herself more than treacherous Judah. Go and proclaim these words to the north and south. Return now, backsliding Israel, saith the Lord, and I will not cause my anger to fall upon you. For I am merciful, saith the Lord. I will not keep anger forever. Only acknowledge thy iniquity, acknowledge your sin, that thou hast transgressed against the Lord thy God, and hast scattered thy ways to the strangers under every tree, and have not obeyed my voice. Now, under every tree, like that, they had those idols, the false gods, you know, up there, and they'd worship them and everything. He's called them harlots for doing it. Turn, O backsliding children, saith the Lord, for I am married to you, and I will take you one of a city and two of a family, and will bring you to Zion. I will give your pastors according to my heart, which shall feed you knowledge and understanding. Ezekiel 33:11, see, God says he doesn't rejoice in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from their sin, turn and live. But see, he doesn't make them turn. He's wanting them to turn because of them loving and caring for him enough. And he's begging the people to turn from their sins. But they're still rejecting his word, Christ. Now, in Jeremiah 26:3, God says in Jeremiah 26:3, if so be they will hearken, and every man turn from his evil way. Now, these evil ways, you know, that we have, rejecting God's word, that I may repent me of the evil. See, he wants to turn from what he had said he was going to do to them, like he did Nineveh. He turned, and, you know, because they humbled themselves and repented and everything, he didn't destroy them like he had had Jonah prophesied that he was going to destroy them. He said, notice that God said, well, he says, if so be they will hearken and turn every one from his evil way, that I may repent me of the evil which I purpose to do unto them because of the evil of their doing. God said that I may repent, which is almost like giving God permission to repent, see, but he's saying that I may repent. When we turn to him with all our heart and seek him and pray, that frees God up then to step in the situation with all his power. And again, the scripture shows that God could not have known ahead of time what choices people make, but he stands ready to change as soon as we will make our changes. In Daniel, this is a long story here, but I'll give you just a brief part of it. Daniel chapter 4, verses 1 through 27, God gave King Nebuchadnezzar 12 months to decide on what he was going to do. He had a troubling dream, and Daniel gave him interpretation of it. And then the interpretation was that King Nebuchadnezzar was going to lose the kingdom and live as a wild beast for a period of time, And Daniel 4:25 states that Nebuchadnezzar would have to live as beast and eat grass. It says, until thou know that the Most High rules the kingdom of men and giveth it to whomsoever he will. Now, he was to receive his kingdom again if he ever humbled himself and you'll turn to the Lord. So, Daniel's advice to the king was to repent, turn from his sin and iniquity, and show mercy to the people. And then the Lord might, you know, lighten his punishment or something. And this is what Daniel states in Daniel 4:27. Wherefore, O king, let my counsel be acceptable unto thee, and break off your sins by righteousness, and thine iniquities by showing mercy to the poor. If it may be a lengthening of thy tranquility. See, he said, you know, that God may not bring this upon you that he said he was going to. Now, Daniel knew it's possible that God might change. He didn't know how and everything like that, but he told the king he should. But in Daniel chapter 4, verse 28 states, and all this came upon King Nebuchadnezzar. You know, so he didn't take Daniel's word. But he waited 12 months. In verse 29, it says that Nebuchadnezzar came forth. At the end of 12 months, he walked to the palace of the kingdom of Babylon. The king spake and said, is not this great Babylon that I have built for the house of the kingdom by the might of my power? Notice he says he built it. He's built it with his power for the honor of my majesty, for his majesty. While the word was in the king's mouth, there fell a voice from heaven saying, O King Nebuchadnezzar, to thee it is spoken, the kingdom is departed from thee. Now God gave him 12 months to make a decision on what he was going to do. And he came out and stated that. And if you want to read the rest of that, that's in Daniel chapter 4, verses 1 through 27. And he had to live with the animals and everything until he would turn from it and everything. But God gave him the choice, and he made the choice and everything. Now, Abraham's son. I've heard many messages on this, but Genesis chapter 22, verses 1 through 12, you know, when God told Abraham to go sacrifice his son. Well, in Genesis 22, 11 to 12, right as Abraham stretched forth his hand with a knife to kill Isaac, when the angel of the Lord called unto him, and he said, Abraham, Abraham, here am I. And the angel said to him, lay not thy hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him. For now I know that thou fearest God, seeing that thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, from me. See, God says, for now I know. He didn't know ahead of time Abraham's total commitment. And he says right here, for now I know. I have heard so many messages on this, and all kind of different interpretations of that. But what the scripture says is that God tested Abraham to find out his total commitment for him. In Exodus chapter 16, verse 4, listen to this. Said to Moses, then the Lord said to Moses, behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a certain rate every day, and I'll prove them whether they will walk in my law or not. See, he is going to test them to see if they will actually obey him by sending the manna. And it'll be easy if they don't obey him, because they're only supposed to get enough for one day, except on Friday when they could get enough for 2 days. But now if they got more during the rest of the week, the next morning it would be stinking, smelly, and worms in it and everything. So it'd be easy to find out who disobeyed the Lord. And then again in Exodus 16:28, and the Lord said to Moses, how long refuse you to keep my commandments and my laws? Now he was speaking to Moses, but he was asking Moses, you know, getting Moses to pass it on to the people, because there were so many of them trying to get too much of the manna and disobeying him still. Now, have next break. I'll be right back in a couple of minutes to finish this up.
The staff of K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network is proud to announce that our very own Rowdy Rick Robinson has been selected as one of the top conservative talk show hosts in the nation for his program America Off the Rails. Again, congratulations to Rowdy Rick Robinson for a job well done. and another reason to stay connected to K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network. Richard's programs will be broadcast live each Sunday morning, 7 Eastern, 6 Central, on K98Talk.com. A podcast will be made so you can listen anytime after the broadcast on Spreaker.com. Put in the search for K98 Talk, then go to the podcast and search for God's Pure Word of Faith, or GPWF. K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we are expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level, or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at sales@k98fm.com. Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books. We'll be right back with more of God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin right here on K98 Talk.
And welcome back. I was just discussing how, you know, God changed for several different people throughout the scriptures, and that they prayed and talked to him, and because of his love for them, he changed the circumstances, and he will for you too. If you'll just seek him with all your heart, if you'll turn to him like that, even the children of Israel, he sent manna to prove them, to see if they would walk in his law or not. Also, now in Deuteronomy 8, chapter 8, verses 2 to 6, here God provided for the people, you know, 40 years in the wilderness and everything. And this was after they rejected and didn't cross into the promised land because they didn't trust God enough to move in. They knew it was his will. And it says in Hebrews chapter 3, verses 12 through 19, in departing from the living God. See, when you depart from God's word, God's word is Christ. You're departing from the living God. And it says that in departing from the living God, they refused to enter into the promised land. And in verse 19 it says, and they failed to enter in because of unbelief. So anytime you know God's will, God's word, and you reject it, you're rejecting the living God, Christ. You're rejecting God's word to you. And God's word, living word, is Christ. Okay? Now, Deuteronomy 8, 22 to 6. And thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness to humble thee. See, to humble us means that we will humble ourselves to his word, and to prove thee, to know what was in thine heart. See, he wanted to get them that 40 years out there to straighten them up, to know what's in their heart, whether thou would keep his commandments or not. God humbled thee and suffered thee to hunger and fed thee with manna, which thou knewest not, neither did thy fathers know, because see, they'd never heard of manna, food and stuff falling out of the heavens for them to eat and everything before. But God did this. And it says, that he might make thee know that man doth not live by bread only, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord doth man live. And every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord is Christ. Christ is God's spoken living word. So we live by Christ. Thy raiment waxed not old upon thee. It said their clothing didn't get old. It says, neither did thy foot swell these 40 years. Thou shalt also consider in thy heart that as a man chastens his son, so the Lord chastens thee. Therefore, thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God and walk in his ways to fear him. God wanted the people to learn to trust and obey him during that 40 years. Now, in Isaiah chapter 5, verses 3 to 4, God expected the children of Israel to change, and they wouldn't. He expected or thought they would, and listen to what it says here. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem, men of Judah, I pray you, between me and my vineyard. See, he was calling his children of Israel in the vineyard, or his, like, what could have been done more in my vineyard than I have not done it, that I have not done it? Wherefore, when I looked that it should bring forth grapes, brought it forth wild grapes. When we read the complete story, we see then that God had done everything he could to draw his people, the vineyard he referred to, back to him. He had expected they'd return to him. See, he had actually expected, but was disappointed by the wild grapes, for they did not return to him as expected. See, now, if he had already known they was going to fail to return, he wouldn't have had that expectation they would return. See, God doesn't know. That's because he loves us so much. He wants us to love and seek him so that we can have the proper fellowship with him that he wants. If he forced us to, you know, that wouldn't be the fellowship God wants. He wants us to come to him because we love him. That's why he gave us free will. Because he wants to, I guess, separate those out that don't. But he expects everybody to, you know, because how can you turn down perfect love? But people do. In fact, in 2 Thessalonians 2:10, the Apostle Paul said that people perish because they fail to receive the love of the truth. In Romans chapter 1, it says we're all brought to a knowledge of the truth. But when we come to that knowledge of the truth, and God reveals himself to us as a young person, whenever that is, that we're a sinner, that we need Christ, we need, you know, to humble ourselves and call out to him and everything. Failing to receive the love of the truth is what causes people to perish. It doesn't say that doubters will go to hell. It says unbelievers go. Unbelievers, people who have known the truth and rejected the love of it. And the love of the truth is Christ. See, because Jesus says in John 6:63, my words are spirit and they are life. See, because his words are life. They're Christ, the living word. Okay. In Jeremiah 3:7, God's expectations again didn't come to pass. And God, I said, after she, Israel, had done all these things, turned out of me, but she returned not. Her treacherous sister, Judah, saw it. Again, Israel rebelled against God so much, he expected them to become unsatisfied with their sin and return to him, but they didn't. And then in Jeremiah 7:31, 19-32. Now, I want to read these scriptures here real quick. Many people know these scriptures are in the Bible. Many people have, you know, we've got 20-something major translations of the scriptures and copies. And every one of them have copied these scriptures here. So that means a lot of people from just translators know. Many people claim to read the Bible through every year. So every one of those people should know that these three scriptures are in the Bible. Ministers all across our nation should know these scriptures are in the Bible. You know, they've studied the Bible so much and everything. And why do I say that? Because listen to what God says in Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 31 first. He's talking about his children of Israel again. And they have built high places of Topet, which is in the valley of the son of Hinnom, to burn their sons and their daughters in the fire, which I commanded them not. Listen, neither came it into my heart. God had not even imagined how evil they would become. God is saying here that it never even came into his heart they could be so evil. Jeremiah 19:5. Now, that was burning their sons and daughters. Jeremiah 19:5, God states, they have built also the high places of Baal to burn their sons with fire for burnt offerings unto Baal, which I commanded them not, nor spake it, neither came it into my mind. Here in the scripture, God is saying, thus saith the Lord, it did not come into my mind how evil they were going to be. So, see, it's not me just sitting here making up some theory or something like this. God said he'd forgive our sin, forget them, because he doesn't want to remember our sins. He wants to fellowship with them. But here God is saying that they did evil that he hadn't even thought of. It was so evil. God gave up his ability in his sovereignty. He gave up his ability to know what choices we'd make, what decisions we'd make, because he wants us to make them out of love. He wants to draw us to make them out of love for him. But he'll honor if we reject it. Now, in Jeremiah 32:35, and they built high places of Baal, which are in the valley of Son of Hinnom, to cause their daughters to pass through the fire to Molech, which I commanded them not, neither came it into my mind that they should do this abomination to cause Judah to sin. God's not sitting up here thinking about all these evil things for us and what's going to happen and everything. Jeremiah 29:11, God says, for I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. What do you think of your kids and grandkids? You ever sit there and think about, well, one of my grandkids is going to be slaughtered in a couple of weeks or something like this? Or you don't sit and think about things like that. You tell your grandkids and warn them, you know, go in pairs, you know, something like this. You know, be careful. You know, look both ways across the street and before you cross the street and things like this. You do everything you can to prepare them, you know, and to keep them, safe and stuff. That's the way God it is for us. But here's three times in the scripture where God says that he had not thought of something that happened, that it did not come in his mind, it did not come in his heart. A lot of people know those scriptures are in there, but they don't have the guts to tell people because it is so different than what everybody expects. They're not bringing out and teaching God's pure word that he doesn't know what choices we're going to make, but he'll live by them, and we have to live by them too. Deuteronomy 29:9, God says, keep therefore the words of this covenant and do them, that you may prosper in all that you do. See, that's what God's wanting us to do. We have a responsibility to shield of our children and things like this. We need to, you know, be praying and seeking God for his pure word. Matthew 25:41, that it is not God's will for any person to go to hell or lake of fire. Separating sheep from the goats, he'll say to them on his left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. See, it's not prepared for people. People are going there because the devil has got people in such division and so much deception and everything that people aren't preaching the true God of the Bible and how much he loves us. He loves us so much he'll forgive and forget our sins. He loves us so much that he gave up his right to know our choices. He wants us to choose him because we love him. And that's the kind of people he wants. It's people that will seek him with all their heart and come to him. And I tell you what, this is someone. He's not a respecter of persons. He respects faith, our acceptance and obedience to his word. And I'm going to play you this song again, Romans Road. If you're out there listening, pray along with him and receive Christ in your heart. For those of you Christians and everything like that, play this podcast over. Listen to it and look up the scriptures and study them yourself. And listen to Brother Terry Church now as he leads us down the Romans Road again.
Tell salvation's plan, and the Christian
simple plan of salvation has been written in God's holy word. Come with me down the Roman road and I'll show you the things that I've heard. Romans 3:23, the Bible says, we've sinned and come short of God's glory. We're all sinners by nature through Adam's sin, as written in the first Bible story. Romans 5:8 speaks of God's love and the fact that Christ died for us. While we were yet sinners, Christ shed his blood on the cross for our sinful lust. Romans 6:23 says the wages of sin is death for an eternity strife. But the gift of God's love through Jesus Christ gives us eternal life. Romans 10:9, if we can believe that Jesus was raised from the dead by God's divine resurrection, by faith, as the Bible said. The 10th verse says, with a mouth confession, salvation can be made. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord will be saved.
The Bible tells salvation's plan, and the Christian must carry on the Lord. So go tell salvation's plan, take someone down the old Roman road.
Today is the day of salvation, so don't put it off for delay. Just bow your head and repeat after me this simple prayer that I pray. Lord, I know I'm a sinner, lost in sin without Christ. By accepting Jesus my Savior, I can have that eternal life. Forgive me of my sin, O God, and save my soul today. Come into my life to live. In Jesus' name I pray. You're now a Christian saved by grace, so carry on the load. Take someone else God's simple plan down the Roman road.
The Bible tells salvation's plan, and the Christian must carry on the Lord. So go tell salvation's plan, take someone down the old Roman road. Take someone.
Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books.
When we pray and, well, we repent and pray, God, because of his love, steps in and changes things and pours out his blessings on us. If we have problems, we should turn to God with all our hearts immediately when we start being concerned about it. And you know, I'm not the most eloquent speaker, and stumble through the broadcast a couple of times. But I do not hesitate to tell anyone that God will step in and change our lives and circumstances, and yours, or whatever you might be in, if you'll turn to the Lord and open your heart to him and just talk to him about it. I know he will. He's done it so many times in my life, other people's lives that I know. One time my young daughter, about 14 to 15 years old, had went to help out in a Christian ministry. And the first day back that night, I had a dream about her that she had been molested. Well, the second day when she came home, I didn't get to see her before then. I called her to the bedroom. I said, has there been any problem or anything like that? Do you have any concern? She just broke down crying. Crying. The guy had been rubbing her shoulders and doing all this and tried to kiss her. And he was such a well-respected man in the community. And my wife and each of us, we loved and cared for him so much, she was afraid, you know, to tell us. But God gave me in a dream what was happening, because, see, parents are supposed to be the umbrella of spiritual protection over the family. Well, we got that situation straightened out real quick and stopped and everything. But see, children are under the umbrella of their parents when they're at home. But when they go out, you've got to have them prepared for a personal relationship with God so that they can take their umbrella and have it with them, theirs. In Isaiah 26, 3 and 4, it says, Thou will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusts in thee. Trust ye in the Lord forever, for the Lord Jehovah is everlasting strength. You know, God has a will for mankind throughout the ages, past, present, future, and he probably not changed that. I say probably because God did change his covenant. See, from the new covenant to the old covenant, God changed that because he was dissatisfied with the relationship of it. He wanted to live in our hearts, not just to be, people's God in an empty heart. And the people of the Old Testament didn't have Christ or, God's Spirit in them. They were just his creatures, and he had his mercy to them and his word to them, but that was it. Let's see, Psalms 25:10 says, and mercy and truth, God's word, are all the ways of the Lord to those who obey his testaments and covenants. So the people of the Old Testament didn't have the new heart that was prophesied that he puts in us. Like again, Ezekiel 36:26, a new heart also will give you, a new spirit will put within you. I'll take away the stony heart of your flesh, give you heart of flesh, and I'll put my spirit in you. That's when we're born into the family, when he puts his spirit in us to live in us. Now, so see, he changed the old covenant. He makes changes. Now, the scripture back here that says, Hebrews 13:8, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. God is the same today as he was in the beginning. This statement about Jesus Christ being the same yesterday and forever is not saying God will not change circumstances or change his mind for things. It's saying he's the same God. His characteristics are still the same. He loves people enough that he'll change for you like he changed for, King Hezekiah when he told him he was sick. And then Hezekiah prayed and God said, I'll give you 15 more years. And he sent Jonah to say that in 40 days, Nineveh, you're going to be destroyed. But they humbled themselves and prayed and turned to him. And he didn't destroy them. See, he will change because of our circumstance. He loves people so much. He loves us with a perfect love that we can't understand. You pick out your little cute little granddaughter or grandson or something like this, or your little baby now, your son or daughter, and just how much you love them. That's nothing compared to how much God loves them and how much God loves all of us. He loves us all with a perfect love. And if there's going to be any tears in heaven, it's when Jesus has to stand before people and say, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you. Just because people didn't humble themselves to God's word and say, Lord, please forgive me. Come into my heart. I could give my life to you. See, we've got to invite him in. He won't force his way in. Now, he's the same God. He's not changed, but he will make changes for us because of our prayers. One of the characteristics is that he will change things for people because he loves. If we'll turn from sin to serve and worship him, and the devil doesn't want people to know the importance of free will choice and that God will change because of our prayers. The devil wants people to think that everything's already planned out and their choices don't make any difference. If it's my time to die, I'll die, and things like this, And as long as people neglect their free will choices, the devil has advantage in their lives. Because, see, people don't seek diligently. Things happened to his children, they became so evil he had never even thought of it. It never come into his mind. It never come into his heart. Never come into his mind. See, I've never heard those discussed from a pulpit or something like that. And people need to know that we have a God that will change if we will turn to him. Hebrews 12:24, and to Jesus, the mediator of new covenant and the blood of sprinklings that speaketh better things than that of Abel. The scripture says in Hebrews 7:22, so much was Jesus made a surety of a better testament. In Hebrews 8:6, but now he hath obtained a more excellent ministry. By how much also he is a mediator of better covenant, established upon better promises. For if the first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. The greatest thing we can do is learn to communicate with the Lord and then accept and obey his word. To be pleasing with Jesus, trust and obey. There's no other way. Trusting and obeying, accepting his word into our heart. And that's what it means to live by faith. To live by faith. And then in John chapter 15 verse 7, where Jesus says, if my words abide in you. See, that's by faith. We've received his word into our heart by faith, and we're accepting and obeying his word in our heart. Ephesians 2:8 says, for by grace are you saved through faith. When we accept God's word that we're a sinner, we accept that Jesus is an answer. We hear the message of the gospel. Hebrews 4:2 says, for unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them, but the word preached unto them did not profit them, not being mixed in faith in them that heard it. See, and that's why people die and go to hell, is because when God brings his good, great news, the gospel, to people, they hear the word of the gospel, but they reject the word of the gospel. Or they reject the love of the gospel, rejecting the word of the gospel. Like 2 Thessalonians 2:10-11, the Apostle Paul says, people perish because they reject the love of the truth. See, when we hear the gospel, hear the truth, and reject Christ from it, Jesus says, my words are spirit and life. You've got to receive his spirit of those words into your heart. Now, John chapter 8, verse 24, Jesus said, I said therefore to you that ye shall die in your sins, for if you believe not that I am he, ye shall die in your sins. We've each got that choice to make. And the Lord loves you so much, he won't force you to make the choice. But he'll do everything but violating that. He'll bless you and bless you and bless you and try to draw you if you'll just turn to him with all your heart. We're out of time today, so let me encourage you then to go to my website. Check out the books on the website. That's www.rahardin.com. Check out the books, the blogs, and the videos. And until next week, good day and God bless you.
You have been listening to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin. Join him again next Sunday morning at 6 a.m. Central, 7 Eastern, here on K98Talk.com and the Spark Radio Network. Also coming soon to the new Grace Radio Network.